so that we will not have any disturbance during the class. If you really want to speak up, you can raise your hand. We will unmute you. And also, you can put your questions in the chat box. So I'll be really happy to answer those questions, right? I'm sharing a small presentation with you and then we can start. So I trust this is visible to all. Can I just get one confirmation that the slide is visible to all of you?
Yeah.
Great, guys. So I'll start this session. I'll start with my brief introduction, guys. I'm Kawaljeet Kaur by qualification. I'm a fellow chartered accountant. I'm a certified fraud examiner. I serve corporates for almost 10 to 12 years in various profile, various industries, various positions. And finally, I left the corporate job, started my own journey in CapEd solution. So I own this company. Now I'm primarily into forensic consulting and forensic training. So part of my profile now to train and do consulting for Big Fours, banks, multinational company, government departments like CBI, Custom, NARCO, SFIO. So these are some of my clients for both training as well as for consulting. The kind of forensics we are major into is more about digital forensics or cyber forensics. So that's a brief introduction of mine. And I'll be really happy to answer your questions. The purpose of this brief webinar is to discuss the career scope in investigation and cyber forensics. If you have any question related to this, you can answer during the session and post the session. A request once again to all of you, please put yourself on mute so that we will not have disturbance during the class. You really want to speak up, unmute yourself and speak. We will be really happy to interact. So guys, let's start discussing a brief about fraud and error and investigation and digital forensics. So can anybody tell me what is the difference between fraud and error? Do you think it's same or it has any kind of difference? Anyone?
Hi, this is Sushmita. I would like to answer that. So the difference what I have understood between fraud and error is the primary thing being the intention. Errors are generally intentional, frauds are intentional.
Absolutely, I agree. So the difference between fraud and error is a malicious intention, correct? When we know what you're doing is wrong and we do it, it's called fraud. Error is something where we do something wrong. Probably the intent was not wrong. We did not know it was wrong. We call it error. Definition wise, very easy to describe. But trust me, when you have to prove that into the court of law, this is one of the most tough thing to prove in the court. Because intent is a subjective term. And when it comes subjectivity, there comes imagination. And it is very difficult to prove in court of law. Because court of law doesn't work on subjectivity, it works on objectivity, facts, evidences. So my quick question once again to all of you. I'm giving a hypothetical situation. You tell me whether it is a fraud or error. I've joined a bank today. I was supposed to credit A's account by 5 lakh rupees. I credited B's account by 5 lakh rupees. Is it fraud or error? If you ask me why you did that, I will say it's an error. I'm new. I'm a new joining. How will you prove that? Anyone? Anyone would like to answer this question?
Yeah, hi, this is Sushmita again. I will just attempt that. Considering you being a new joinee, if you come from a similar career background experience, then I would not say it was an error. Probably would have been more conscious about it. Mm-hmm. So that would be one stand where, you know, I would like to go ahead and examine further. And what is the benefit you have derived from by doing that?
Yeah, Okay, SharePoint. Anyone else would like to answer?
Anil this side, it's an error. We can prove that it's a fraud.
It's an error. This is what you said, Anil?
Yeah. We can prove this.
You can prove
in court of,
is it?
Yeah. We don't have any intention. We can't prove this in court of law. That's it's a fraud.
Right. So guys, that's exactly where the difference between audit and investigation starts. I'm assuming that most of you are either from the audit or from financial background or from investigation background. Am I right? I hope this is the kind of audience we have right now. So guys, normally there is a difference between audit and investigation. There's a famous saying, auditor is a watchdog, not a bloodhound. So when we do audit, we go with skeptical mindset. We assume something may not be right, but we don't think as an auditor the fraud has occurred. Whereas when we do investigation, we believe that fraud has already been done. We have to just find the evidences to prove whether it was done or not, and if it was done, how. So that's the core difference between audit and investigation, that in investigation, we believe the fraud has already occurred. So we work like a bloodhound. We don't work like a watchdog, right? So please understand the difference between, because that's exactly where the difference arises between two, right? Now, the question arises, how will we prove whether it was fraud or error? So by default, we will not assume whether it was fraud or error. We will connect the dots backward. We will try to find the nexus between the person who has got 5 lakh and me. If you could not find any single relationship between us, could be an error. But otherwise, it could be a fraud. If you ask any fraudster why you did that, a fraudster would say, no, I have not done it. It was an error. Right? But it is our job as an investigator to prove whether it was fraud or error. Connect the dots backward. Try to find the relationship. And trust me, these days fraudsters are so smart. You wouldn't find a direct relationship between them. They wouldn't be husband-wife. They wouldn't be a family member. Probably, I was supposed to pay to the vendor. I used somebody else's account to pay vendor. It would be as simple as the relationship. So this is how we start investigation. And that is where I say the audit and investigation are actually two different fields. The way we do investigation is very different than the way we do audits. A request, if you really want to make your career in investigation, the first thing and first rule to be learned is think like a fraudster. If you can't think like a fraudster, you can never find the fraud. Trust me, you can never find the fraud. Reason being, the fraudster always would try to outsmart you. The fraudster is not thinking straight the way you are thinking. And if you keep thinking straight, you may never be able to find the fraud. So I hope we are sorted so far, are we? So fraud and error looks very simple to define, but pretty tough to prove. Now, on the lighter note, I have a question to ask. Assuming most of you are working, are you guys doing fraud in day in, day out? Are you guys involved in any kind of fraud in daily basis or maybe regular basis? What do you
think? I'm not involved in fraud, but yes, I manage fraud.
Great. Sure. What if I was able to prove that we all are involved in some kind?
Yes, we are all are in fraud. I must say, Kamaljeet.
I'm happy to know that you honestly believe, and that's actually fact. So guys, all of you who are working and who've been doing CA training or whatever, how many times you have picked up office pen and taken home? How many times you have used office printer and scanner for personal purpose? You've done it or you have not done it ever?
Yes. look like a fraud, because I'm using someone's property without their knowledge or something like that.
Great. So if I have to ask a true false question, the answer is
true. Answer Great. Is true.
Got it.
I'm so, sorry, but I would differ over here, because every organization accepts that their systems could be used for a very minimum personal use, and organizations are okay with that. So why are we calling that as a fraud?
So I'm coming back to that. It's tough to, you know, believe that we are actually doing a fraud, but technically, do you know what it is called? It's called asset misappropriation. And asset misappropriation is world's largest or the most frequently done fraud, not only India. Across world, asset misappropriation is the most frequently done fraud. However, the monetary loss to the company may not be as high from this fraud as financial statement fraud. We may have our own justifications to believe that this is not fraud. For example, the company has given it for us only, right? Another justification. Company anyways doesn't pay enough salary. What difference will it make if I take a 10 rupees pen? Let's take a revenge from the company. My bonus was due. Company has not given me bonus. Why can't I pick up a pen? That's called rationalization. So guys, if I go slightly back in the history, forensic or this investigation is not a new field at all. It's more than 60, 70 year old profession. It's just that in recent time, the profession is becoming more prominent and more important. If you go back slightly back in 1990s and talk about Enron and WorldCom, which are till date world's largest corporate scam, from there, the need of investigation or forensic accounting has become more prominent. However, if you go back in 1934, these kind of terms have started coming. And then the concept came called fraud triangle. Fraud triangle was actually introduced quite a lot. It was a history, but till date, when you make forensic report, we use fraud triangle. So there is a simple triangle which has three angles: the financial need or financial pressure, justification or rationalization, and the third is opportunity. When these three points come together, people commit crime, people commit fraud. The financial pressure may or may not be real. We can actually call it perceived financial pressure. Anybody who lives beyond mean will always be under financial pressure. You talk about world's largest corporate scam, you talk about a lot of infamous frauds these days, be it Nirav Modi, be it Kingfisher case. Where was the financial need? The financial need was perceived, was not real. The greed, fear of losing power, this is just part of financial need. The second comes rationalization. Rationalization is justification. Why would you do that? So justification is another angle, how people justify their act. And the third is opportunity. I read an article which says that if given an opportunity, everyone, each one of us will do a crime. We have not done it because we have not got enough opportunity. So opportunity plays very important role, guys. A company with weaker internal control always give opportunity to commit crime. If you will not get opportunity, you will never be able to commit crime. Take an example of Nirav Modi case once again. Without involvement of bank official, do you really think an outsider can do such a crime? Just not possible. So opportunity, the weaker internal control. And these three angles comes together and make an interesting concept called fraud triangle. Till date, when we make our forensic audit reports, we use this angle called fraud triangle, right? So when it comes to fraud and error, the moment I said that taking pen or using office printer, is it fraud? Most of us might think, no, it is just not fraud. Maybe because the monetary value is too less. Maybe we may have our own rationalization. Fraud is fraud. You ask a big fraudster, like people involved in Enron, WorldCom, Nirav Modi case, Kingfisher case, any XYZ case. they may have their own justification too. But then that doesn't mean that it was not a fraud. So that's how we have to distinguish between fraud and error, and that's where our task as an investigator starts. So we always work on facts. We always work on evidences. There is no role of subjectivity in our profession. So this is how we do. Anyone, any questions so far related to whatever we have discussed so far? In the meantime, I'm showing some statistics. Probably that gives you a good view as to where we stand. So this is a report card of cyber crime cases in India. Of course, the data is only till 2019, Jan to August. Suppose that a lot of data is not even available, or maybe it's not been incorporated in these graphs yet. So we can see we are going good, we're progressing. Unfortunately, not a good progress. The top 20 countries impacted by cybercrime. US tops the chart. We are right now at little lesser, just 3%. But again, I'm not too sure how authentic this data could be. Because there are a lot of time that cybercrime cases are not being reported or not being incorporated in the statistics. Many of us do get a call from so-called bank to take a card, and a lot of kind of cybercrimes happen, but many people do not even report it, right? So this data may not have actual numbers. So this is where we stand when it comes to cybercrime. Now, once we have understood a brief about the fraud and error, it's time for us to understand an interesting concept called forensic audit. I've seen a lot of people using investigation and forensic audit as an interchangeable word, but there is a small difference between two. So let me tell you what is the difference. Forensic means litigation supported. So forensic accounting or forensic auditing is always for litigation. The litigation can be today, can be tomorrow, can be after 10 years, after 50 years. But then the purpose was always for litigation. So that's a forensic audit. It is an examination and evaluation of evidences, which is for court of law. Forensic accounting is a substream of forensic audit. The investigation may or may not end up in the court. It can be done for a personal, as an individual, or it can be done for a company. Here we try to collect evidences. The report may or may not end up in the court. It may be for internal company purpose as well. So that's the difference between investigation and forensic audit. Forensic audit, litigation supported. Investigation may or may not. So that's where the difference arises between forensic audit and investigation. I assume that since we are in this session, you may have some kind of inclination to come in this profession and be an investigator. So there are some skill sets which are necessary or which are required in this profession if you really want to be a good investigator. So those are the skill set. The remarkable curiosity. If you are a person who really wants to know how this has happened, why, then probably this is the best profession for you. Use of technology. If we are into investigation and we do not know the technology, or we are not comfortable working with technology, then I'm afraid you would not be able to make it big in this profession. So technology plays real, real important role in this, because today, what is data? Data is not on register. Data is in computers, laptop, mobile, pads. That's it. That's exactly where the data is. And we have to play with that data. We have to investigate that data. So technology plays a very important role. Then communicate effectively. You have to be people's person. This profession is not about numbers. If you are having financial background like a CA or similar, it's gonna be a good thing for you. It helps. But that's not all about it. Even if you are from engineering background, medical background, or non-financial background, you can still do very good in this profession. But you have to be people's person. Imagine a scenario that you have investigated a case. You went to CFO and asked, have you done this? And then CFO will say, yes, yes, I've done this fraud. No. And we are not a law enforcement officer who can use third degree and people will speak up. So all the way you have to use your interpersonal skill so that people will open up with you. They'll talk to you. The more they talk, the more information you get. So you have to communicate effectively. And then you have to have very good analytical and research skill. How many of you have really tried to know me before coming for this session? Or let me give another hypothetical question. After doing this session, you would like to know probably more about me. Where will you go online and search? Anyone? Suppose you are curious to know more about me. So where will you search? Anyone?
LinkedIn.
LinkedIn, okay. What else?
Google.
Sorry?
Probably search you on Google.
Google, okay.
Reviews about you on Google, reviews.
Okay. As an individual, but what will you get from Google? Let's say you went to LinkedIn. LinkedIn people talk about their achievements, their career, their jobs. Suppose you have to really investigate and want to know whether I live beyond means. Will that suffice? Can you go to my LinkedIn page and know whether I'm living beyond means? Probably not.
Kamaljit, we can search you on Facebook, Twitter.
Okay. Just for your maybe reference, I'm not on Facebook.
But we can search it through your profiles, your friends. We can search it through LinkedIn, your connections and Facebook. I mean, we have to just make a dot of you. I mean, how many friends you are, how many connections you have on Twitter and LinkedIn, and then we can search it on Facebook. What your personal profile, what is your background.
Right. So guys, the point here is you have to have research skills.
And search you on. Search you on Google and see on whichever links or pages your name pops up. And then probably go and search on those particular pages.
Very good. And don't
so then,
also, guys. So here, my point here is, you have to have research skills. Suppose you, even if you found me and on Facebook, just for your reference first that I'm not on Facebook, so there is no point me searching and my friend searching. I'm there on Facebook, you can never find me. Anyways, I'm an investigator by profession. However, so let's say instead of me, you are searching ABC. You may have gone to his or her profile, but that doesn't mean that it discloses anything. It may also not disclose much by going to friend's profile. It's just an eye. Suppose there are 10 pictures I have posted on my page or my friend has posted on my picture which I have liked or other way around. The way you analyze those 10 pictures makes a lot of difference. A very basic example I'm giving. Suppose you have posted your picture with your friends or maybe family for a holiday. Like you guys went for a holiday. It's a family picture. You are standing in some kind of hotel. Now this same picture. Everybody see this picture from different angle. Your friends, families will see and they say, wow, we are looking very good and blah, blah, blah. Suppose I'm a third party. I may be looking at this picture from altogether different angle. What are you wearing? What kind of accessory your family is wearing? What kind of hotel you may be standing in? Are you standing in a five-star kind of hotel or a basic kind of hotel? Now that gives me a lot of insight as to what could be your lifestyle. In this, a small picture, same picture which everybody must be looking at on Facebook, but then when you look at it, look at from a different point of view. Another example, the company's audited financial statements are publicly available, freely available. Anybody can go on Google and download it, correct? About 100 plus pages for a big company. Most of a financial person would like to go to balance sheet, P&L account, and director's report and understand it and read it, and that's it. If a competitor has to see this report, what would competitor would like to see in this report? Suppose I'm your company's competitor and I want to know what are you planning to do in next year. Can you tell me from this financial statement, how will I get to know that? Where should I see? It's a freely publicly available data. Anyone? Anyone? So let me give a small example. In manufacturing industry, or these days most of the industry, there is a sustainability reporting. There is a statement called environmental impact statement, which is mandatory for company to publish. Doesn't have choice. If I'm a competitor, I will go and read that. Now you might be thinking, what will I do with environmental impact statement? In environmental statement, the company has to give the data as to how much pollution they are planning to do in the next 1 year or next 4 or 5 years. Me as a competitor would be able to understand if the pollution level is going real down. Probably there is a change of technology. Probably my competitor is planning a drastic change in the technology in coming year. Or the units or the production level or the pollution level is planning to go up. Probably my company, the competitor is scaling it up, doubling the production. Now, this is freely available data, but the way other people see it and we as an investigator see is big difference. So I hope you have got the point. The same data, two people see from a different angle and interpret differently. Am I clear? So next time when you try to search someone, don't just go by their public profile. Again, if you go by, let's say, LinkedIn, people are showcasing on LinkedIn what they want to do. I would want you to see what is there on the LinkedIn, but I may not want you to see certain thing, and those certain thing may interest you for investigation. So that's where analytical and research skills comes into picture. Unlike audit, where most of our work is on paper, investigation may have lot of clues beyond papers. So think beyond papers as well, right? Anyone, any questions so far? Any questions, please? Fair point. So that's about analytical and research skill. Ability to think creatively. I just gave an example how we creative somebody can be. The more creative you are, the more successful you are in this profession. Persistence. No matter how much we want, we generally don't get data easily. So we don't get evidences easily. So it has to be persistence. And finally, skeptical mind. Don't get impressed with what you see. A company's gross profit going up year by year, theoretically may be very good sign. I may not be happy with that. I would really want to know why. Whether sale is going up or COGS is going down. And if sale is going up and COGS is going down, then my question is why? How company is able to manage it? So don't buy what you see. Be skeptical. Be curious to know how is it possible. So these are some skill set which are required for investigation of forensic audit profession. Some kind of categories where we can get the work. So if we talk about India, we talk about across globe, doesn't matter which country you belong to. As I see, some of my audience are not from India. So these pointers which I have given so far or I'm gonna give now, it doesn't belong to any specific country. The beauty of this profession is that you can work across globe. It does not matter which country you are in or you're planning to be in. The career scope is same, the need is same, and the packages are really, really good. Whether you are in India, you're outside India, whether you are in developed country, developing countries, doesn't matter. The demand is exactly same. I've been into this profession since long now, so I can tell you with my own experience, the profession has very good demand. Fraud is there today, or fraud will be there tomorrow as well. You will never ever get outdated in this profession. So some kind of categories of financial forensic engagements could be, majorly we get assignment for economic damage calculations. Many times insurance companies and other companies, research companies may come to you where they would like to know the economic damage calculation, the real one, not the one what you have got on paper. There could be a lot of post-acquisition disputes such as breach of warranties, etc., where the need may arise. These days, there's an insolvency code in India where the demand for fraud investigators have really gone up because there are many cases in insolvency when may not be genuine insolvencies. So again, the demand comes. Security fraud, tax fraud, money laundering. These are some of the assignments which we get a lot of assignments from. Business valuation, and finally e-discovery, or what you call digital forensics or computer forensics. So these are some fields where we see huge demand of investigators. If you are in job, you can work across industries. Again, my answer is global, for India and for outside India as well. You can work in banks, you can work in NBFCs, you can work in insurance companies, e-tailing company like Amazon, Flipkart, you can work in Big Force, you can work in consulting. You can start your own consulting as well. Even if you're not a chartered accountant, it does not matter. You don't need a specific license to start your own practice. You can very well get into your own practice also. The market is huge there as well. If you are in some kind of practice, if you are CA, you can get yourself impaneled with banks, insurance companies, SFIO, CBI, Delhi police, other police. These are the assignments you can get. So again, you can be in job, you can be outside job. The career scope is still very good. The career path is very good. And why it is very good? Because unfortunately, frauds are really on peak. This lockdown is tough for every industry, but not for fraudsters. I mean, I'm getting a lot of calls from people who are in my circle who've been telling me that the banking frauds are really going up during this period. So fraudsters have not, you know, they are not demotivated to do fraud as of now. Right? So no matter how tough the market today may be, the demand for such professional, I don't see they going down, right? A quick brief slide just to show you the difference between normal audit and fraud examination. Just spend few minutes and let me know if you have any question here. It's a basic difference between audit and fraud examination. Any questions, guys? Anyone, any question? Ali, you have any question? First, assuming no question. Then the question arises, in case again you are auditor and you want to know what is the connection between audit and investigation, and even if you are not auditor and let's say you are working in a bank or something and you want to know that if you have to affix the responsibility of an auditor, how will that be? So the connection between audit and investigation, there are certain acts, just for your reference I'm giving here. In India, Section 143, Subsection 12 of the Company Act 2013, it fixes the auditor's responsibility on reporting the fraud incidents. If auditor is doing audit and if you come across any fraud red flags or symptom, or if he thinks that fraud has occurred, he has to report. There was a time when audit and investigation used to be two different fields, and auditors did not have any kind of responsibility when it comes to fraud, no longer now. So Section 143 of Company Act 2013 says so. Internationally, International Standards on Audit 315 and ISA 240 both talk about same, that auditors have to report any risk and material misstatement in financial statements. So we cannot say that audit and investigations have no linkage. They do have. Now another question, that if you want to get into investigation, what are the skills that required? What are the certifications required? Some kind of certification and qualification I'm going to discussing. The first is the Certified Fraud Examiner, CFE. It's a US-based qualification. The governing body is in Austin and the name is ACFE. The globally most recognized certification in fraud investigation. I'm myself a CFE. That's something which is a small certification, takes about 2.5 to 3 months time of study. And then definitely it helps you in getting your skill set upgraded in fraud examination. Quite sought after in corporates. If you want to get into anti-money laundering, then there is a certification called AML by ACAMS, again, a global body. A very good certification if you are into financial institutions. Huge in demand. In fact, recently I've seen quite a lot of demand in Amazon and Flipkart also for anti-money laundering. Identity theft is another big challenge we are seeing in India now. It was back there in the Western countries before, but now we have seen quite a lot cases of identity theft in India as well. So there are certification in identity theft where you can get yourself certified and identify whether the case is of identity theft or not. And then if you really want to have degrees, then you can get into bachelor's and master's in criminology. There are a lot of wings available, whether you want to get into digital forensics, criminology, criminal psychology, you can think about getting those degrees also. So these are some qualifications which could help you to be an investigator. Now, before I move to the next segment about digital forensics, anyone, any question? I would be happy to answer. So far, anyone, any question?
Ma'am, yes, Lakshmi please. Here. So I just wanted to understand, if somebody wants to get into forensics and has a bachelor's or master's in commerce and has been working in the financial institution space, in the BFSI space, so how would doing these courses, one, benefit, and secondly, how do we go about doing these particular courses?
So Lakshmi, one, that we may have required experience and knowledge, but sometimes corporates really want to see that on paper as well. And I have seen, because I'm praying to a lot of corporates also, sometimes it's company sponsored program, so company really want these certifications have with employees. That helps getting career movement. So if you really want to go up in the hierarchy, I've seen companies which says that if you come with CFE, we'll give you promotion. So this really helps. Also, tomorrow, if you want to go to next company or change the industry altogether, probably this certification will help you there as well. Because let's say if you talk about CFE, CFE doesn't train you only for banking or financial institution. It talks about every single fraud in every single industry, be it insurance or be it any other industry. So you can take a career movement as well. So that's how it helps touch me. And the, another point is how we go about it. So it's my first session where we just talk about the, it's a glimpses of what we can do. Maybe if you guys all are willing, maybe we can have more webinars in future. We talk about each and every certification in detail as to how we can go about it, how we can support you and so on. So that's how we can definitely plan, right? So I hope that's me. I have answered your question well. Any other pointer?
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Guys, any other question? Well, so assuming that no question at this moment, so now I'm moving to the next point where, which we call it digital forensics. So guys, fraud investigation and digital forensics, we may think are two different fields. Yes, there are definitely few points which are different. However, if you are an investigator and you do not carry the knowledge of cyber part, then it's difficult to be successful in this profession. Because as I said, the data is these days is all digital, right? Whether it is computers or your mobile phone or it is tablet, at the end of the day, the data is in binary form, zero and one. So that's where it is important to think about the cyber forensics also. Now, first, let me explain what is the meaning of digital investigation and digital forensics. These are two different terms. Again, a lot of people use these terms as interchangeable, but unfortunately, there are not two different terms, right? So let me tell you what exactly is digital forensics. As we discussed, forensic accounting is litigation supported, so is digital forensics. The other name of digital forensics could be computer forensics or e-forensics or e-discovery. What is digital forensics? When you try to recover the permanently deleted files, you call it digital forensics. For example, I knew that you're going to investigate my mobile phone. I've completely erased my data. I'm not talking about recycle bin. Completely erased. Now that's where the need of digital forensics arises. E-discovery. Or otherwise also, if not just permanently deleted file, but the collection of evidences producing in the court of law. So that's called digital forensics. Digital investigation is something where we analyze the data which is in binary form, zero and one form. Any digital data investigation of that is called digital investigation. So that's the difference between digital forensics and digital investigation. And you'll be amazed to know that how many digital forensic experts are there in India. So let's use your assumptions. Tell me how many forensic experts do you think may be there in India? You know the population of India, of course, yes? And tell me how many digital forensic experts do you think may be there in India right now? Guesswork would find.
Prox, 1 lakh.
Sorry?
Around 5,000.
Mm-hmm. Higher number. 5,000 is a very high number. Go down. Yes, sir.
500 there?
2,500.
Okay.
2,500.
Right. So, unfortunately, the answer is in hundreds, not in thousands.
500?
There are a lot of people. Let's take 500 as a random number. 500, 700. Now imagine the population of India and look at the kind of cyber crimes we see in the market and look at the professionals available in India. And not in India, across the world, you wouldn't find many professionals. You may find a lot of people who say, we do this, we do that, a lot of websites. But when you go there and get the work done, you'll find not many people know how to do it. That's where we see market, that's where we see career scope. Now, I know that it's a very difficult time and frankly, nobody knows what's going to happen to the industries now. But tell me, where do you see this demand going down? Even during this lockdown period, even we are still seeing a lot of cyber crimes happening. then when cyber crime happen, don't you think that demand for professionals will also be arising? Huge market. Imagine the population and hundreds professionals, and that's it. What we have to do in this? Some people who are from technical background, who have degree in IT, it would be really good for them to get into that. Even if you do not have degree in IT, there are still few things which you can do. So we'll talk about those certification. Some may be hardcore within IT, but some where you can definitely get into it, they may not be very technically IT, as in you don't need too much of coding, etc. Correct? So you can get into it. And if you ask me, I'm a chartered accountant by qualification. I'm myself not an IT professional, but if you have a flair, you really want to learn, you have that keeda as to how this has happened, probably you will really enjoy being into this field, right? You know that your phone can be imaged and cloned, and somebody can see you from, let's say, sitting in Russia. Can anybody tell me the difference between imaging and cloning? Imaging, what do you think? A name suggests mirror image. So there are two words.
Imaging means, this is Suman Saurabh. Imaging means they will have some data of your phones, so that pictures or videos. But in case of cloning, they will have the live version of your phone at their own place.
Okay, slight correction. Suppose you have used a software, put in on my laptop, and then mirror image comes. So whatever is data is there on my system today, you can see it. It's called imaging. Imaging only image what is there in my software and hardware right now. But when you go for cloning, it will also have which was there in my system sometime, now I have deleted. So cloning is something which will completely take away all the data from your system. Even if you have deleted it, it was sometime there on your system. However, image can only take what is there today. Both imaging and cloning generally are not real time, guys. Suppose I have captured your laptop today and I have done imaging and cloning, I can only see till date. Post that, I may not be able to see what you're doing. But what I'm saying is there are spying software available. And if I put that in your mobile phone or in your laptop, then it doesn't matter how far you go from me. I can see in real time what you do. And putting software, I may not need your system in my hand. Please put my cell phone on. Thank you. In order to put that spying software, it's not necessary that I need to have access of your phone in my hand. If I get it, well and good. If I don't get it, there can still be a lot of options. I can simply send you a game link which says, can I access your contact? Can I access your pictures? Sufficient. If you're using Android, most of you would click on that, yes. Sometimes it doesn't even ask for the permission. Have you ever thought why gaming app needs the access of your contacts? What does gaming app has to do with your pictures? So you have opened a window of your house, stranger is already there, and then you ask the stranger not to go ahead and see. Be careful with all the links what you get. Be careful what with system updates, unless and until you see the update is from the genuine source. Anyways, coming back to the field, so when you talk about digital part, we talk about these kind of professions where we may help the companies retrieving the data, we may help with the investigation, we may also support in litigation when it comes to digital forensics. A lot of things which are there in the market today where your data analytical skills comes into picture. Let's say talk about big data. Can anybody tell me what is big data, please? Anyone heard about it? Big data. big data is a very data common
that
term.
Is the combination of the structure and unstructured data.
Okay. So for example, when there's a huge data, let's say a company has about 10,000 branches per day, there are about 1,000-2,000 transactions. Multiply these with 365. Now the data has become big data. So we are not talking any theoretical concept anymore. The data is too much to handle. So big data has three V's: volume, velocity, and variety. The data is too much, volume. The data is dynamic, velocity, and data has variety. Data doesn't mean numbers only. The data can be audio, video, pictures, anything. That's a data. So in order to deal the big data, we use data mining tools. That's where data analytical skill set comes into picture. So data mining tools help slicing up the big data and handling the big data. Most of you who are working, your company must be using both big data and data mining tools, which are inbuilt in your softwares. So probably that's why you may not have concentrated too much. But then otherwise, you should know how the backend works. The kind of companies you might be working in, they are not dealing with small level of data. It's huge data, and it's a dynamic data, right? Then question arises, how we make career in cybersecurity? You can become forensic expert. When you become forensic expert, you actually protect the cyber world and assist law enforcement. So that can be in various forms. You can work in a company, you can work as a consultant, but that's where you can work as a forensic expert. If you are an IT professional, the best profession or the best hierarchy you can look at is CISO, Chief Information Security Officer, which is at par of your top management like CFO, CEO, CTO. If you have expertise in computer security and business acumen, CISO position is not just for IT, it is also your risk management, risk governance. So that's where this is the best profession we can look at, and the kind of packages these people may have. Easily, it can be about 2 to 3 crore per annum in India. So I'm very serious about this profession, but you need to have more experience and sometime more certification, qualification. The IT, if you have heard about COBIT, we have talked about risk management certification, this is something. Then comes security auditors. Here, you don't need to be hardcore IT people. If you have heard about CISA, so CISA is a certification to become a security auditor. So these auditors goes and check the computers, their operations, their management, their input, their output, the contingency plan, the data prevention, all these things something are taken care of by security auditors. They also make a report like a financial auditor. Security auditors can work for financial audits, non-financial audit like operational. It can be compliance or it can be investigative. So the demand is huge. They make a report, give it to management. They also help external auditors and sometimes third parties as well. So you can become a security auditor as well. Some glimpses how the educational qualification and skill work if you want to be CISO or you want to become forensic computer analyst. It's just for your reference. Mostly you need to have some kind of IT background that helps. But if you do not have typical IT background and you're working on IT project, that may count. So this is small slide for you. But then if you look at this, you may find a lot of skill set which are required, not just IT, but analytical ability, report writing skill, communication skills. You need to have good risk management, governance skills. So this is also required. And finally comes, what are the qualifications which could be there in cybersecurity? This is just few point of qualification. There can be a lot many other, but then these are more popular. The first is CISA, Certified Information System Auditor. You don't need to be from IT background only to do that. And I would recommend you guys to think about CISA. If you are working on IT related projects, if you have required experience about 3 to 5 years, think about it. It's a global certification, globally recognized, highly paid job. Certified Information Security Manager, CISM. As compared to CISA, CISM is slightly easier. However, it may need more of IT background, though it doesn't have any coding kind of exam, but then some kind of more IT knowledge is required. So both CISM and CISA are governed by a body called ISACA. CISSP, Certified Information System Security Professional. Huge demand of this profession in market. Companies hire a lot. Every company is using computer and they need these kind of security professional who support in system security. And finally comes Certified Ethical Hacker. CEH is a profession where anyone can go in. If you are IT people, it will be really cakewalk for you. If you're not IT, you may have tough time a bit in the beginning when you start the certification. But then, even if you do not have IT background, you can still make it an ethical hacking. So hacking, I am assuming you would know, unauthorized access of somebody else's system. Ethical hacking, when we don't do this for fun, we support the company, we support law enforcement, and we call it certified ethical hacker. So these are some qualification in cybersecurity. So that's a brief of the discussion today, where we just try to understand what is the career scope in investigation and forensics. Of course, each and every point can be discussed quite in detail. We can have more detailed discussions. But first thing first, I would like to know your questions, whatever we have discussed so far. And post that, before winding up, we would like to understand that what kind of session you want me to have more in future, so that I can plan it accordingly and we can have more targeted discussion on that particular point. So guys, any question, I'll be happy to answer.
Thanks, Ms. Kanwaljit. Session is very well covered and every information is captured. I won't recommend any changes to be done because this will help a lot of amateurs and the young people who are coming in this department. I won't recommend being myself a fraud practitioner and, you know, or working for activity for quite long time. I won't recommend any changes to this presentation. It is too detailed and very well presented. Thank you for the same.
Thank you so much. Is open to discussion. So I'm done with my side of discussion. Anything you would like to know, discuss, now open discussion.
Yeah, one point I want to touch is, how is the scenario going to be a fraud risk scenario in the COVID situation? Like, what are the strengths and weaknesses? Are the current practices by banks and FIs is going to suffice the current scenario? If you can, that will be better for everyone.
Absolutely. So point taken. I'll definitely come up with this kind of session very soon. Thank you so much for your feedback.
Thanks a lot.
This is Kiran Bhatia here from Mumbai. The session was really good and really thankful to you that you have given some of the very good insight about that. Like a 2 certification which you have shared, about certification, mm-hmm. fraud examination and financial fraud. How you can help us? I'm just talking from my side because I'm also CISA. So how you can help us about this certification and the training or whatever is there? So if you can share us, that it would be really great.
Sure. So Kiran, thank you so much. Just to give a pointer, guys, CFE or Certified Fraud Examiner is something which I've been teaching since 2012 now. And if you Google my company's name, CapEd Solution, you may find it that we've been training for CFE since long. And And most of the people in India who are CFEs been trained by us. So I do online interactive session right now. We do have face-to-face sessions also in Delhi. So that's something where I can support you for CFE. And other than CFE, we've been planning a new batches for anti-money laundering and CISA as well. CISA and CISMO. So those kind of certifications, some of them we are teaching, we can always support. Some of them we are not teaching right now, but then if you're interested, I can definitely support you to the extent possible in terms of getting the study material or in terms of connecting you to the right source. So that's how I would love to help you, Piran, on that.
Thank you.
Any other questions, any other pointers for us?
Any plan to launch a short-term course or a tablet course on a Udemy or a Coursera or on a LinkedIn Learning?
So probably CFE is something which is a short-term, can be started. And that's where we do give, if you say, tablet course in that case. We can have a quick snapshot. There are two ways to study for this. One is that we have detailed sessions where each and every point is discussed on weekend. Another could be which we do for corporates, where we do, you know, at a stretch 4-5 days, and then maybe you can plan your exams accordingly. So that's something can be done. And the best part is that during this lockdown, we all have time to study, which generally we don't get while commuting, while going to offices. So my suggestion is that, guys, use this time, invest on yourself. I'm being a little rude when I talk, but then company never loves us back. We have to love ourselves, right? So when it comes to work commitment, there'll always be commitments, but you have to keep investing in your skill set. No matter how experienced or qualified you are today, don't think that this is sufficient. Unfortunately, in dynamic environment, you have to keep upgrading your skill set, guys, right? So that's my suggestion. Think about all those certifications we discussed. You think about other certification. I'll be happy to support you on that as well. But then keep doing it. If you guys are interested in knowing about these certifications, what we can do, we have the list of email IDs who are registered. We can send some kind of snapshot for those certifications on the mail. And basis your interest, we can take it next step. But that's entirely with your consent. We don't want to get into those kind of chasing. We generally, so if you guys want it, we would be happy to do that.
Thank you.
All right, guys. So thank you so much for attending my session, and the recording of this session, I'll make it live on my LinkedIn page as well as on YouTube. The contact detail of ours are there on the slide. Anytime you want to touch base with us, please feel free to do that. And thank you once again. We will be happy to connect once again in the future. And stay safe. Thank you so much for attending the session. Looking forward to seeing you once again. Take care, guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am.
Thank you.